We continue our study of the Trinity, and we've been looking at misinterpretations of the Trinity. We first of all looked at tritheism, the idea that there are three separate and distinct gods, as opposed to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, who are equal and united and in one essence. We looked at Sabellianism or modalism, the suggestion that God has manifested himself as three persons, or three actors, or three roles. We looked at Arianism, which is also Unitarianism, in which they taught that God was the only uncreated one, and that Jesus Christ was created by the Father, and that Jesus Christ had a time in which he did not exist, and he came into existence. We emphasized that the biblical doctrine or explanation of the Trinity is that God is one in regard to essence, God is three with respect to persons, the three persons have distinct relationships, and the three persons are equal in authority. The Old Testament certainly has hints of the Trinity, but the Trinity or the triunity of God is primarily something that is more clearly or explicitly revealed in the New Testament. We do have, for instance, in Genesis 1:26, it says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move around the ground." So the emphasis on our there certainly indicates some pluralism. May not be understood as Trinitarianism yet, but certainly a pluralism. Again, in Genesis 3:22, "And the Lord said, the man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil." Or in Genesis 11:7, when God is mockingly speaking of the people who were building the Tower of Babel, it says, "Come, let us go down and confuse their language, so they will not understand each other." So we see that there are hints of this in the Old Testament. Isaiah 6:8, at the call of Isaiah to ministry, it says, "Who will go for us?" So we do have shadows of Trinity in the Old Testament, but the Trinity is primarily or more clearly revealed in the New Testament. The Father is called God in 1 Corinthians 8:6. The Son is called God in Hebrews 1:8 through 10, and the Holy Spirit is called God in Acts 5:3 through 4. But along with the fact that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are called God, is also the truth of the Scriptures, that God is one, Deuteronomy 6 and verse 4. Now, there are some difficulties with this doctrine as far as explanation. Most of the need of explanation is the result of the fact that people do not understand the terminology of some of the New Testament words. For instance, one is the meaning of begotten. Matthew 1:20, it says, "But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit," or "what is begotten in her is of the Holy Spirit." The argument is that if something is begotten, it cannot be divine. The misunderstanding here is the fact that there is a God-man. God became man to reveal himself, God's self, to us. And although it is difficult for us to understand that there could be the embodiment of God in man, it is a mystery, but it is also true. A second term that is difficult to understand is the meaning of firstborn. Now, the firstborn terminology must be understood in the context of preeminence. For instance, in Romans 8:29, it says, "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren." Firstborn here is not chronological, so much as it is quantitative. In other words, or qualitative. The fact is that Jesus Christ is qualitatively above all others. In Colossians 1:15, it says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. It doesn't mean that he was the firstborn in creation, as Mormonism or Jehovah's Witnesses would try to argue. What it means is that he is the first. He is preeminent. He is above all, like Colossians 1:18. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. Hebrews 1:6 says, And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world. Well, certainly Jesus was not the firstborn human being. The firstborn here emphasizes preeminence. The verse goes on to say, He says, God says, Let all God's angels worship him. So, firstborn has to do with a title of preeminence. This certainly comes forward in Revelation 1:5. Where it says, And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. Yes, Jesus Christ is the firstborn. He is the preeminent one amongst those of the resurrection. A third term in which we have difficulty at times is the meaning of only begotten. This is found, for instance, in John 1:14 and 1:18. We need to understand this terminology, though, not as emphasizing only begotten as in the only one born, but only begotten is better understood or translated as the one and only or the unique one. Let me illustrate this for you. In John 1:14, it says, The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only begotten, better translated, the unique and special one, or the one and unique one, who came from the Father full of grace and truth. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and unique one, at the Father's side, has made him known. Now, to illustrate this, let's look at a passage in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 17, where the exact same phrase is used of Isaac. It says, By faith Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promises was about to sacrifice his only begotten. Now, was Isaac his only begotten son? No. There was Ishmael before Isaac, and after Sarah died, Abraham married a wife, Keturah, and he had other children from her. And so, Isaac is not the only begotten, he is the one and unique son. He was the son of the promise. And so we see that although there are difficulties because of translations for us to understand the Trinity, and the concept of the Trinity is certainly something that is difficult for us to illustrate, the Bible affirms very clearly that God is three, that the three are one essence, that each is God, and that they collectively, they are God. Now let's turn our attention to the work of God and the work of God in his decrees. The definition of God's decrees represents the teaching regarding the divine plan of God. God's decrees represent the plan that God had in eternity past, which he set in motion so that we might learn to glorify him. In Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 4, it says, The Lord works out everything for his own ends, even the wicked for a day of disaster. Or Proverbs 16:33 says, The lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. Zechariah 1:6 says, But did not my words and my decrees, which I commanded my servants the prophets, did they not overtake your forefathers? Then they repented and said, The Lord Almighty has done to us what our ways and practices deserve, just as he determined to do so. Yes, God in eternity past has set in motion a plan. That plan was set in motion by his decree. Job testified in Job 42:2, I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. The psalmist testified in Psalms 139:16, Your eyes saw my unformed substance. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came into being. The truth is that in eternity past, God had an infinite amount of plans that he could pick. But he chose one plan, and he set it in motion, that he might glorify himself, and that we might have fellowship with him for eternity. And so some of the major characteristics of God's plan involve this. First of all, the decree is a single plan encompassing all things. Secondly, the decree covering all things was formed in eternity past, but it is manifested in time. It was decided in the past, but is manifested in time. The decree is a wise plan, because God, who is wise, has planned what is best. And then finally, the decree is according to God's sovereign will. He does as he pleases. The decree of God is intuitive. It is the fact that God knows all the details of the plan before the plan begins. It is not a plan that is based upon experience. Now, when we describe the decrees of God, we basically, from a finite or human perspective, divide it into two categories. The first is the directive will of God, and that is everything that is accomplished. The second one is the permissive will of God. The permissive will of God involves God allowing acts that are contrary to what would be his glory, or contrary to righteousness, or contrary to what is good, but in God's permissive will, he allows it, but he still directs it for his honor and glory. For instance, it says in Acts 2:23, This man, meaning Jesus, was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. It was always God's purpose that Jesus Christ come and that Jesus Christ die for our sins. But it does not negate the fact that God permissively allowed wicked people to sin in accomplishing that plan. Again, Acts 4:27 says, Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and your will had decided beforehand should happen. Yes, Herod and Pontius, the Gentiles and the Jews, conspired against Jesus, but in God's permissive will, he directed it according to his purpose that we might enjoy our redemption. And so as we study the decrees of God, we need to see that in eternity past, God has decided what will be accomplished. He is directing things and he is permitting things, but all things will accomplish for his honor and glory. We can take comfort in the fact that the triune Godhead has decided in eternity past to accomplish our salvation. God planned it, Jesus Christ executed it, the Holy Spirit is carrying it out, and we get to enjoy the benefits of it. All that comes to life is all part of God's plan. We are preparing now to live for eternity with God.
We continue our study of theology proper, and we have been looking at the decrees of God. God's plan, God's all-encompassing plan by which he accomplishes his will. And we said that the decree of God is a single plan encompassing all things. In eternity past, God decided that he would reveal himself to man and bring glory to himself through a particular plan. We stated that the decree covers all things that were formed in eternity past, but they are manifested in time. The decision of God's decree was in eternity past, but the execution or the fulfillment of that decree is in time. The decree is a wise plan because God is wise and has planned what is best. The plan is a plan that is a loving plan. because God is a loving God. He is righteous, and so the plan represents all that there is about God's attributes. The decree is according to God's sovereign will. He does as he pleases. And then we looked at the fact that the purpose of the decree is the glory of God. Although all things are encompassed in the decree, and the main purpose of the decree is the glory of God, we need to remember that man is responsible for his actions. God will reward people according to their good works or their sinful behavior. Colossians 1:16 says, "For by him, for by God, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him." Colossians involves the heavenly realm and the earthly realm, the totality of all that there is of God's creation. And all of that totality was created for his honor and glory. Ephesians chapter 1:5 says, "He predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves." Yes, God has predestined us to be his children. He has predestined the plan of our salvation, and this was all according to the good pleasure of his will. But the ultimate purpose is that we might recognize and give praise and thanksgiving for his glorious grace. We need not take for granted the greatness of our salvation. We need to offer up from our lips the sacrifice of praise to God. Revelation 4:11 says, "You are worthy, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have been created." We need to pause and reflect upon our salvation from time to time. Certainly at our communion services, when we partake of the bread and the wine, this is an opportunity to pause. But each and every day we need to pause. Oh, we begin to gripe about the problems of the world and the problems of our world and the problems of our day. But let's bring it all into perspective. Let's pause and let's think about where we'd be apart from Jesus Christ. Where would we be apart from God's grace and help? Let us give thanks for our salvation. Isaiah 48:11 says this, For my own sake I do this. How can I let myself be defamed? I will not yield my glory to another. God's ultimate purpose, according to the harmony of the triunity and the harmony of their attributes, is to accomplish their goodwill and good pleasure in their world and in our lives. Now, some aspects of the decree of God are carried out by people. People do accomplish God's will in obedience and disobedience. Psalms 119:91 says, "Your laws endure to this day, for all things serve you." In Acts 13:48, it said, "When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed to eternal life believed." The Gentiles and their salvation were all part of God's eternal purpose. Ephesians 2:10 says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do." God's will and purpose is carried out by people, and particularly by his people. Ephesians teaches us that we are his workmanship. If any person be in Christ Jesus, they are what? New creations. The old things pass away, and all things become new. We are God's workmanship. We have been created in Christ Jesus. For what purpose? To have a happy life? That's not the main reason. To become part of the country club of Christianity? That's not the main purpose. So that we will be blessed and prosperous and our children in like ways? No, that's not the main purpose. But that we can serve God, that we can carry out the good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. Yes, God does have a plan for our life, and it includes more than just fire insurance or salvation. It involves sanctification and sacrifice and service to Him. What kind of good works are you doing for God in your home, in your neighborhood, in your job situation, in your community, and in your church? Sometimes we think that all the good works of God are done in the local church. The local church is the place where we prepare to go forth and to do the good works of God also in the world. Luke 22:22 says, "The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to the man who betrays him." Here's a verse that shows us the divine, sovereign part of God's plan and the human free will responsible part of man. Yes, it was decreed that the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, would die upon the cross, but woe to and responsibility to the man, that is Judas, who betrays him. Here's another verse, Acts 2:23, that shows us this blend. "This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge," this man being a reference to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was handed over. That was part of God's purpose. That was part of His foreknowledge. "And you, with the help of wicked men, put Him to death by nailing Him to the cross." There is a divine aspect to God's plan. There is a human aspect of responsibility. Acts 4:27 says, "Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city. And they met to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen." Yes, Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles, and the Jews, who conspired in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, were all responsible for their actions, even though their actions carried about and carried out the divine will and decree of God. So God's decree involves all of His plan. It is intuitive. In other words, it is not established or learned by experience. It is not adjusted from time to time. It is something that when God set in motion, He knew every detail of it and He was to accomplish it. The manifestation of the decree of God is seen over the material realm. The creation of the world and the universe and all its aspects comes under the divine decree of God. Psalms 33, 6, 7, and 8 say, "By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry hosts by the breath of His mouth. He gathered the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere Him. For He spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm." Verses 10 and 11 go on, "The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of His heart through all generations." Yes, God has His plan. Job 14:5 says, "Man's days are determined. You have decreed the number of his months and have set limits. He cannot succeed." God knows the span of our lives. And we cannot add one day or one cubit of stature to our day or our size by the worry and the fretting that we often exercise. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not supposed to be good stewards and responsible for our bodies and our minds and our complete being. This temple is the only temple that we have in which to serve God. If we abuse it and misuse it, then our temple will not be fit and ready for the Master's use. So, yes, God has determined things, but we don't know what those things are. In the meantime, we fulfill His will by following the principles of His Word. Acts 17:26 says, "From one man He made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and He determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live." So God has rule over the material realm. God also has rule over the social realm. God has decreed the family and ordained that marriage should be indissoluble. The decree of marriage also involves children. God has established government. Moreover, he is the one who establishes and removes kings. And we see God's rule over the social realm. God has decreed and defined the family. We can have women's conferences in China to try to define the family. We can have our president or a particular sociological group try to define the family. But their definition is not the definition. The definition of an absolute true truth is defined by God. And God defined family as a man and a woman. Therefore shall a man leave his mother and father, he shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And then he commanded them to be fruitful and to multiply. When God created his people, he created them male and female. And any violation of the creative order of God's family is a violation of his will. God has ordained marriage that it should be indissoluble. He has said that he hates divorce. Yes, God allows it, but he hates it. And the marriage bond is to remain pure. He has decreed the establishment of government, but government is to be guided by the reward of those who are good and the punishment of those who are evil, Romans chapter 13. Government should be regulated by the law and the principles of God, by the principles of rewarding good ethics, good work, good service, and that is defined by obedience to God's word and God's will. And government should punish that which is evil, that which is a violation of law, and that which is sin. So God has a decree over the social realm. God also has a decree over the spiritual realm. He rules in the heavens and he rules in the earth. He rules over the angelic realm and all of its levels of influence. And so, over the material realm, the social realm, and the spiritual realm, God rules. Beloved, does God rule in your life today? Does he rule over your spiritual realm, over your social realm, over your material realm? Seek first the kingdom of God and all that that involves. Seek first the kingdom of God, and God will add all other things unto you. May God's will be over each and every one of the realms of your life. We've been studying the decrees of God under theology proper, and we looked at how the decrees of God oversee the material realm, that is all of his creation, the social realm, that is the orders that he has established, like family and government, and the decree of God that oversees the spiritual realm, that is our salvation in the process of our sanctification. Additionally, we need to address the question of how does sin fit in with the decree of God? Additional issues relate to the question of how can a holy God use sin or allow sin as part of the process of his decree? Well, first of all, God may permit men to manifest evil. Romans chapter 1, verses 24 through 28. God does allow man the freedom and the responsibility to reject his revelation and to deviate from his moral law. God is never, however, the author of evil, nor does he solicit people to sin. James chapter 1, verse 13. God at times may directly prevent evil, like we see in 2 Thessalonians 2:7, with the prevention of sin and the restriction of sin. God may direct evil acts by men to accomplish his purpose, as we see in Acts chapter 4, verses 27 and 28, and in the life of Judas. God does not make men sin, and yet all things are within the scope of God's sovereign plan. God determines the boundaries of evil and overrules evil at times. Job chapter 1, verses 6 through 12. God limited Satan in his testing of Job. But God does use sin and use evil for his plan to demonstrate his sovereignty and to demonstrate his glory in contrast to the sinfulness of mankind. In relationship to salvation, God has chose and predestined, predetermined believers to salvation from before the foundations of the world, Ephesians chapter 1 and verses 4 and 5. Also 2 Timothy 1:9. God chose Jews and God chose Gentiles to be united together in the body of Christ, Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 11. And God chooses believers to bestow individual blessings upon them throughout their lives. So God's decree is an all-encompassing one that represents what he is accomplishing in his world. Now, some people would object and say, well, the Bible does not allow for man's free will. Yet, the Bible emphasizes that there is responsibility and accountability. The Bible emphasizes man's responsibility or accountability more than it does free will. Man is free within the bounds of his sinful nature. Man is responsible for the decisions that he makes within the bounds or slavery of that nature. The unsaved is bound to a sinful nature until the grace of God is offered and accepted. God's grace is extended to all, and it is man's responsibility to accept God's message of salvation and be set free from the bondage of sin. Romans chapter 6 and verse 16 says, "Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you wholeheartedly obeyed the form of the teaching to which you were entrusted, that being the gospel of Jesus Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, acknowledging that we are sinners and that we are trusting in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 15. Paul concludes in Romans chapter 6, verse 18, "You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness." And so, God does allow free will or responsibility, accountability within the bounds of their nature. Another objection is that the decree makes it unnecessary to preach the gospel, that it impedes the motivation to preach the gospel. Now, the command to obey has nothing to do with the ultimate fulfillment of God's plan, since God has ordered it. We know that God will save the people whom he has predestined. The opportunity to preach the gospel is a privilege given to us so that we might participate in the blessings of God. God's sovereignty will stand, though. God's sovereignty should motivate us to witness, since we know that he is going to save people. If I were to tell you that I snuck into your home and that I hid a $1,000 check somewhere in your home, that if you found it, you could have it and use it, well, you would tear the place apart until you found that $1,000 check, because you would want the joy of the discovery of it. In the same sense, God tells us that he has chosen before the foundations of the world that he is going to save people. And therefore, all we need to do is to go out and share the gospel with them to find out who the saved people are and where they are. The motivation should be greater believing in the sovereign decree of God concerning people's salvation, that it is my job to simply go out and look for opportunities and give people opportunities to hear the gospel. And if I begin to share with them and they are confrontational, or they are rejecting, or they are not interested, then I can wait, I can stop, because it is obvious that God has not yet softened their heart. But I have to be ready. I have to be ready to share and to give people the good news of the gospel. But let it be a motivation that God has chosen people. Therefore, it's my opportunity to seek opportunities to be an ambassador for Jesus Christ and to share with them. Well, what are some of the implications for these decrees? The one all-encompassing decree, the decree of God. First of all, we should stand in awe of a great God who is wise, powerful, and loving. What a great God that we have, that He is able to intuitively establish His plan. Secondly, we can entrust our entire lives to our Almighty God. He knows the details. Let us follow Him and let us obey Him. We should rejoice in the wonder of our salvation, that we were the choice of God in eternity past. We should rejoice in the blessings of God through the process of salvation. We need to rest in the peace that we have observed in a tumultuous world, knowing that God is in control. Sometimes God calms the storm, sometimes God calms His child in the midst of the storm. Our world is in a storm. Our culture is in a storm. And we need to be calm in the midst of it all, knowing that God is still in control. We need to also remember that God holds people responsible for their actions, in both reward and in judgment. And God holds people responsible for sin. Although sin does not frustrate the plan of God, neither is He the author of it. And we need to take responsibility for our actions. This kind of teaching militates or argues against the pride of man, because those things which are accomplished for good and for God's glory are ultimately a recognition of His sovereign work in His humble servants. And so the sovereignty of God should be something that we take comfort in. It is something that we should be motivated by. Now, in the decree of God, we need to look at God's relationship to His creation. The Bible places great emphasis and significance upon the creation of God. It was a significant part of early church doctrine. And its effect upon our understanding of other doctrines is important also, such as anthropology, the study of man, soteriology, the study of our salvation, and hamartiology, the study of sin. You see, man was created by God as a separate being. Man did not emanate from God, but God created him. And man has come from the hand of a good God. He is not a carryover from the work of some evil being, but man is made in the image of God. And therefore, an understanding of creation will help us to understand our own origin. First of all, some of the elements to the biblical teaching of creation. First of all, that God created what we see now out of nothing, creation ex nihilo. The idea is that God first had to create the matter and the substance before He could form the design of creation and of man. God, standing in eternity past, before creation, created the matter and then created us as His people. The scriptures go on and on with statements about things that God has done from the beginning of the world. It says, from the foundation of the world, Matthew 13:35. From the foundation of the world, Ephesians 1:4. From the beginning of the world, Matthew 24:21. From the beginning of creation, which God created, Mark 13:19. Thou, Lord, didst found the earth in the beginning, Hebrews 1:10. And so we see the Bible certainly reflect upon the existence of God's decree and His plan before creation of matter or the design of the world ever came into existence. Paul says that God calls into existence the things that do not exist, Romans chapter 4 and verse 17. God also said, let light shine out of darkness, 2 Corinthians 4:6. This surely suggests the effect occurred without the use of any previous material, that God spoke the word, is what we see in Genesis 1, and things came into existence. God created the world by His word. Hebrews 11:3 says, so that which is seen was made out of things which do not appear. Theology proper and the Bible teaches us that creation was accomplished by the Word of God as He first brought matter, the matter of the earth, the matter of the universe, the matter of all that we see into existence, and then he designed it and he fashioned it. Today, as we listen to reports from the Hubble telescope, from the Galileo space probe, and from the scientists who are seeing into the depths of the universe and other universes, which we have never understood before and still know so little about, we can know this absolute true truth, and that is that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He created them by the word of his power. He upholds them by the word of his power. And the things that are seen were created out of things that are not seen. God created our world. And we must begin with that theological understanding. It is God who holds our world together. And as we look at the greatness of our world, let us not wonder about its beginning, but let's wonder about its creator. And in humility, praise him and thank him that in all of the vast resources and stretches of the universe that God chose to visit us through Jesus Christ and to share the love of Christ through the good news of the gospel.